3 years ago, Britain voted to leave the European Union. Today, the country still has no real plan on how to do so. Theresa May tried, but ultimately failed, forcing her to resign. Now the race to become the new leader of the Conservative Party, and therefore the Prime Minister, is well and truly underway. And of course, at the centre of every candidate's campaign is Brexit. On Sunday, the main contenders fought it out in their first televised debate, albeit with one notable absentee. The former Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson refused to take part. But he remains the favourite, and his tough stance on Brexit has appealed to many within his party. He's promised to leave the EU with or without a deal. So is he the best man to take over and deliver Brexit, whatever that means? Well, let's ask our guests. In Shropshire is Peter Wilding. He was an advisor to the former British Prime Minister David Cameron. He's the chairman of British Influence, and he's also the one who coined the phrase Brexit. Simon Richards is in Bristol. He's the CEO of the Freedom Association and co-founder of the Better Off Out campaign. And in Brussels, we have former Conservative MEP Sajjad Karim. Gentlemen, good to have you on the programme. Peter Wilding, the most important question at the top of everything else before we get into anything else. Did you trademark the word?
I've always thought that would have been the best thing ever. But unfortunately, the law is you can never copyright a word.
Oh, mate.
So that's the sad truth of the matter. So you could have been rich. Talk about it, but yeah. Not profit from it.
You could have been rich. Instead, you're stuck on my show. So sorry for you. Let me get down to business now. So Peter Wilding, Brexit sort of brought us here. Who is the best candidate to either deliver it or sort it out as we look at all these Conservative candidates?
Well, delivering it comes into two forms. First of all, there's the delivery of Brexit by simply exiting the European Union on October the 31st. That can either be in a no-deal scenario, or it can be by another device, which is essentially to leave the European Union, but to avoid economic harm, to stay in the single market and indeed the customs union for a short period of time, whilst the new government negotiates a new deal. So there are two options available. The candidates have found themselves in a remarkable muddle, primarily because their members who will vote on the next prime minister are essentially Farageists. 76% in the latest opinion polls want to leave the European Union just without a deal. So we are in a battle between the pragmatic and the ideological at the moment. Now, who's going to be the best to deliver? We don't know, because it's not in Britain's gift. If we are not prepared to leave without a deal on October the 31st, then we depend upon the European Union giving us another extension to get things sorted out, which would be via a general election or a new referendum. And because the next Prime Minister needs to discuss these matters with the European Union, then really, we are not, sadly, and rather humiliatingly, in command of our own destiny at the moment.
Simon Richards, between the pragmatic ones and the more ideological Farageists, as we heard from the other guests, who's going to win this and whose candidate is going to be the next Prime Minister?
I think that the most pragmatic option is actually the one that Boris Johnson is taking up. And what Boris is saying is that he wants a deal. That's a deal different from the withdrawal agreement that Theresa May was trying to push through. But he does want a deal and is prepared to negotiate, obviously, with the EU on that. But that he realises that in order to get that deal, to get a deal that's fair for the country, you have to be prepared, genuinely prepared, not just saying it, you have to be genuinely prepared to walk away with no deal. And I think that's the pragmatic position, because I must say I would like him to get a deal. It obviously has to be one that will pass muster with Conservative members and voters. But that if you go in and rule out a no deal, I think that's the extreme option. If you go in and rule out a no deal, you're never going to get a decent deal.
Simon, are you maybe attributing pragmatism to his opportunism and flip-flopping over the years? Are you maybe incorrectly saying, well, maybe this guy's a pragmatist, whereas he's just in it for himself?
I think he is a pragmatist, but I also think he's genuine. It wasn't easy for Boris back in 2016 to come out for Brexit, because his father had been a member of the European Parliament. His sister is very pro-EU, so is his brother, another Tory MP. So it wasn't easy for him, and I think he was right to take some time on it. But since then, since he put his head above the parapet, and of course won that referendum against all the odds, he has actually, I think, been quite consistent. And he was trying to get a deal, but I think it was difficult for him because the Prime Minister essentially went behind his back did a separate deal, or tried to do a separate deal with the EU. So I don't really accept that Boris is a flip-flopper.
Right.
Nobody in politics can be 100% ideologically pure.
Okay, Sajjad Karim. So Simon Richards is, in a way, giving us an explanation as to why so many members of the Conservative Party would choose Boris Johnson at this particular point in time. Do you accept and agree with that? And does that justify why he seems to be the outstanding candidate right now?
Well, I just find the whole thing actually quite farcical in so many different ways, because 3 years down the line, Britain is still navel-gazing. You have really here a candidate in Boris Johnson who all he is doing is pulling fluff out of his belly and presenting it as something new, some sort of candy floss that's going to taste sweeter this time round. It isn't. The fact of the matter is this. He is saying, I'm going to renegotiate the withdrawal agreement. Well, your negotiating partner, the European Union, is saying, no, you're not. And then he's saying, well, I'm going to put a full stop to the backstop. And your negotiating partner, the EU of 27, is saying, no, Mr. Johnson, no, you are not. So the fact is, we are still now entering a new form of ridiculousness, where this game is once again going to be played out with the British electorate, giving them false hope, false promises which simply cannot be presented. And I'm afraid, come October the 31st, once again, the train is going to hit the buffers, and we are going to find ourselves in a situation of a cul-de-sac with absolutely no way out yet again, unless the European Union is then willing to throw us a further lifeline to give us another extension. But let me tell you this, I'm in Brussels at the moment, and from every single conversation I have had with very senior decision makers right across Europe and within the EU institutions, the message is abundantly clear. If we elect Boris Johnson as leader and prime minister, then we can forget a further extension. That rug is going to be pulled from under our feet, and I'm afraid Boris Johnson is going to find himself staring in the face the very proposition that he is putting forward today, that I can leave without a deal. The response will be, OK, son, that's what you wanted, that's what you argued for, that's the basis upon which you won your leadership, we're going to give it to you. You are leaving without a deal.
So, Peter Wilding, this is what I don't understand. If, and we've known this for a while, if the Europeans are saying anyone but Boris, yet members of the Conservative Party are still probably going to go for Boris. No disrespect to the other men in the running for now, but he's the outstanding candidate. Aren't they setting the nation up for another catastrophic train wreck?
Yes. But it's not their fault. The problem with the last 3 years, and in fact, let's be frank, 40 years of British discussion about Britain's membership of the European Union, is that it's been based on fantasy for all of those decades. Britain had a leading role in the European Union, completing the single market, being the leading power, bringing in the countries of Central and Eastern Europe. But the problem was that whilst we were very successful in the European Union, the British political establishment and the British media establishment never, ever sold to the British public how Britain functioned as one of the big three in Europe. It is a disaster, and it is a fundamental failure of statecraft in the United Kingdom over these intervening period of time. So we're left where we are in your question. We're left with a public that is essentially confused, an establishment that essentially is not prepared to tell the public the truth, and you have politicians in hock with the media, which is controlled effectively by Rupert Murdoch, the Barclay brothers, who want out of the European Union, mainly for their own commercial benefit and reasons. And so you have this witch's brew in which Britain is sleepwalking to either disaster, as myself and Sarge would believe, or to liberation, a kind of millennium fantasy where we'll be out of the European Union. And what is extraordinary about this, the people that I've spoken to here in the UK, they don't appreciate that the consequences of leaving without a deal is probably the dismemberment of the United Kingdom, because Scotland and subsequently Northern Ireland want to be part of Europe, but also the collapse of the British political party system as we know it, and its potential replacement by a Farageist right and a Marxist left. I mean, this is the definition of a political, economic, social, and cultural crisis. But nobody is telling the truth. And that really is a tragedy for a country that, frankly, a lot of member states, a lot of nations respect.
Simon, it takes us back to the argument made 3 years ago, and an argument that has been made ever since then repeatedly by those who want to stay within the European Union, because they say that, well, while the vote might have been democratic, people didn't know what they were getting themselves into. Do you buy that?
I certainly don't. And the arguments that Peter and Sajjad are making were arguments that we had back then. In fact, they were arguments that had been going on for about 40 years. People did know what they were voting for. You might as well say that people don't know what they're voting for at a general election. You have to trust the people. That's what democracy is all about. And I don't accept this idea that we're heading for ruin outside the European Union. And of course, we're not leaving Europe. We remain involved in almost all the European institutions and world institutions. But we only want to be like the majority of other countries in the world, free to make our own decisions.
Okay, but nobody's disputing that, Simon. Sorry to interrupt you, and I don't want this to sound as if we're ganging up on you here, right? But I mean, when you hear from someone like Peter saying that there will be the dismemberment of the UK if there's no deal and there's the crashing out of Europe, Boris Johnson says he wants to get rid of the Irish backstop. The Europeans might not want to negotiate any of that. If the Irish backstop goes away and there's a hard border, for example, trouble in Northern Ireland or the troubles in Northern Ireland could kick off again, you can foresee all of this happening, right? I mean, yes, it's your right to decide what you want to do, but these are very tangible, real things that are right around the corner. Do you accept that?
I do, but what you need is somebody who actually believes in Brexit. The problem that's been so far is that Theresa May didn't believe in Brexit. She saw it as damage limitation, and therefore she never put the positive case for it. Now, I happen to be Welsh. The majority of people in Wales voted for Brexit. We voted, in fact, as a United Kingdom. The largest party in Northern Ireland, the DUP, is strongly in favour of Brexit. And people in Scotland also understand that they can't become an independent country. Spain and other countries would veto it. I think the problem is that people have seen Brexit in such a negative way, because contrary to the idea that the press is all pro-Brexit, the majority aren't. The Daily Mail, for example, has turned very much against Brexit. The fact is that people want to control their own lives, and it's incredibly patronising to say all the time that people didn't know what they were voting for. Okay. They knew perfectly well what they were voting for. The problem is they've been denied it ever since.
Let's go to the man who lost his seat recently in Brussels as an MEP, Sajjad Karim. You had an interesting reaction When Simon said we need a true believer in Brexit and Theresa May was not a true believer, tell me why.
I mean, I just find the whole thing absolutely fantastical. And it just reminded me of the five candidates in their Channel 4 debate. I think it was yesterday or the day before. And Rory Stewart, one of the candidates, gave the example that his wife had asked him to go and take the rubbish outside and put it in the bin. There was far more rubbish than the bin space available. But he said, I was trying to convince myself, believe in the bin, believe in the bin. But you know what? The rubbish still wouldn't fit in the bin. This is not a question of if you believe the parameters of the reality of what you are dealing with is going to change. It isn't. The negotiating parameters remain exactly what they are. They are very tightly legally defined. And this is the one mistake I think many, many people make. And this comes through from those that supported Brexit. They think this is almost a negotiation between two countries where absolutely everything can change. It isn't. This is a negotiation between the United Kingdom and the European Union. And the European Union is a rules-based organisation which has to negotiate in accordance with the parameters of those rules. Those cannot change. It's not like a government that can automatically say, right, OK, well, we're going to do it this way, we're going to change that. It can't do it. The parameters are set, and that's what you have got to work in. So this idea...
But isn't that one of the reasons why people voted for Brexit? Sorry to interrupt you, Sajjad. One of the reasons why people voted for Brexit was because they didn't like this idea of this bureaucracy in Brussels where they say, oh, my God, these are the rules and these are decided and we don't have any flexibility. Isn't that a part of the reason why so many Britons decided they want to opt out?
I think that's a big part of the misunderstanding that had been presented to the British people, because the fact of the matter is this, that we are a part of this organisation. We are a part of the rules-making processes and procedures, and a very influential part of that. The vast majority of what actually happens here that concerns us goes our way. But the British people have never been informed this. And it is the same with every international institution that you may deal with, whether it's the WTO, whether it's NATO, whether it's the United Nations. And therefore, to take the logical steps is the next step then to move one step away from our involvement in those organisations. There are many people who are today beginning to advocate exactly that. Where does that leave United Kingdom standing genuinely then as an island alone? I don't see how that works in the modern world. It simply doesn't.
Simon Richards, has Sajjad Karim managed to convince you at all?
He hasn't. And I have to say, I can understand him being a bit bitter about it. You know, he's lost his job as a result of this. I probably feel the same.
There's no need for that sort of personal attack, please. Stick to the issues that I've raised.
Well, it's
this
just
is
a
not
statement
about
of fact.
Personalities. I haven't attacked your person. I've attacked your arguments. Please deal with the arguments that I've presented.
I'm not attacking his personality, I'm just stating a fact. The fact is that most of the British people do not benefit from membership of the European Union. And they've had plenty of time to consider that. They are not anti-international involvement.
Simply not true.
We're in favour of being involved in Europe and the world.
That statement means actually nothing.
Okay.
That statement that has just been presented is, one, factually untrue.
Okay, and this
and secondly, it actually means nothing.
Okay, and the two of you are clearly on opposite ends with regards Brexit. I want to circle it all the way back to this race. So, Peter Wilding, there's a process of elimination, there's going to be some culling, and eventually there'll be a new Conservative Party leader who will be the Prime Minister. Can we say with confidence that none of these others, the Rory Stewarts, the Sajid Javids, Dominic Raabs, Michael Gove, none of them stand a chance against Boris? Can we say that confidently?
No. As the phrase goes, the only person who can lose this election is Boris Johnson himself, given his track record of indiscretions, gaffes, etc. I think the odds are that he will win because he is the favourite of the Conservative establishment as well as the Conservative members. However, Rory Stewart does have a very attractive alternative offer. My view is I don't see him getting into the last two. And so it's Boris's to lose. But even if he wins, unless he has a kind of 100-day plan in which he resolves the Brexit question by getting out, I think the real thing, tragically, in fact, the political poison could be taken out if Britain leaves. I don't think it's right for the country, but I think most Brits don't care about the single market, the customs union, etc. Sadly, what they care about is just getting out. And I think his determination will be to achieve that. What he will seek to do is probably this, is that he will place a high Brexiteer, somebody like Dominic Raab, in charge of the trade negotiations which might follow, and try and change the narrative to a kind of Churchillian blood, toil, sweat and tears, we Brits can do this, Shakespearean sceptred isle type of narrative, and potentially call a general election. A general election which, frankly, he will be up against a septuagenarian Marxist. And frankly, that is the kind of battle that anybody would like. So it depends how creative Boris Johnson and his acolytes are. If he's not creative, the chances of Boris Johnson's premiership collapsing in destruction quickly are very high. The chances of a national government are quite high. People don't realize that we're reaching the end game now, and we're a matter of 3 months away from what could be the biggest political crisis in Britain since 1931.
Right. Sajjad Karim, very finally, a lot of people asking whether the Tories self-destructing in many ways over the past few months played into the hands of Labour, but Peter Wilding's suggestion that Boris could actually create a national momentum leading up to a general election, where he's up against a Jeremy Corbyn who Peter described in not very flattering terms. Does the Tory party still have that confidence that they could defeat Labour and Jeremy Corbyn, and Jeremy Corbyn's just a septuagenarian Marxist, as he put it, if it comes to a general election? Or is maybe Peter Wilding underestimating Corbyn and the left?
Well, I say to you this as a committed conservative. Once again, the hand of history is actually placing itself on the shoulder of the Conservative Party. And the fact that the Conservative Party seems intent on pressing the self-destruct button, the natural consequence of that is not going to be anything good for the unity of the United Kingdom itself. Now, this goes fundamentally against the grain of everything that it means to be conservative. And therefore, at this moment in time, more than you really do have to go back some several decades before you arrive at a similar point. We are once again at an absolutely pivotal moment. And depending upon the direction that the United Kingdom chooses to take through the decision as to who is to be the next leader of the Conservative Party, that is going to determine what sort of United Kingdom is going to emerge come October the 31st. We really are, as Peter quite rightly said, now in the absolute end game. This is eyeball to eyeball stuff now. And what comes out of this is going to really set in train whether there is a United Kingdom, if there is a United Kingdom, what type of United Kingdom it is, what political structures we have, what constitutional order we are going to have, and indeed, what sort of political makeup is going to exist in the constituent parts of the United Kingdom will determine exactly what sort of society we are to be. I'm very fearful that I don't see any of this ending well if we carry on the trajectory that we are currently seeming to still be chasing after, something that doesn't exist in reality.
This won't end well, says Sajjad Karim. Final word to Simon Richards. Simon, absolute end game? Are the stakes that high?
We're certainly entering very choppy waters. I agree with the other two people about that. But I think this is about hope versus fear. I have great belief in this country, and I believe Boris Johnson has. And there's been a real issue of trust because the referendum has not been put in place, it has not been enacted. And until we get rid of that issue of mistrust of politicians, we're not going to get far. But I really believe that Britain has a very bright Brexit future, and a future that is all about engaging with Europe and with the rest of the world.
Simon Richards, Sajjad Karim and Peter Wilding, pleasure having you all on The Newsmakers.